Hello everyone, welcome to Disha classes. Today we are going to discuss about the circulatory system. The circulatory system is the major system which will help in the survival of an organism. There are two types of organisms, unicellular organisms and multicellular organisms. Unicellular organisms are the single celled organisms and multicellular organisms consist of more than one type of cells. Example for unicellular organisms can be taken as amoeba, and for multicellular organisms we can take many other cells such as muscle cell, fat cell, bone cell, stem cell, epithelial cell and blood cells and many more. For an organism to survive in an environment, it requires different materials or substances called as nutrients, gases and liquids, which will help them in proper functioning of the body. Unicellular organisms will be depending upon the one cell for all the functions, and this cell will perform all the functions through diffusion and osmosis and many other more. Multicellular organisms will be depending upon different types of systems, as the diffusion and the osmosis could not perform all the functions. And it will be difficult for these two processes to transport the bulk amount of materials faster and in efficient way. So they will be depending upon different systems which will help them to survive. So, we'll discuss about human circulatory system. Human circulatory system will be transporting the materials from different parts of the body to the other parts. To understand the circulatory system, it is important to know the structure of heart and the functioning of heart. Then only we can have a clear idea of the circulatory system. So, from now, we'll be looking after the location of the heart. The first stage, the heart is located within the thoracic cavity of the body. This space is called as thoracic cavity. And the heart is situated between the lungs. The space, this space is mediastinum, where the heart will be located. In the mediastinum, the heart is separated from other structures by a tough membrane called as pericardium, or it is also called as pericardial sac, because within the sac the heart will be situated. Pericardial sac is situated in a space called pericardial cavity, or it is also called as space of heart in simple terms. So, the dorsal surface of the heart lies near the vertebrae and the anterior surface deep to the sternum and costal cartilages. Here we can see in a small diagram over here, the dorsal surface is near the vertebrae and the anterior surface deep to the sternum and costal cartilages. These are the costal cartilages, and over here near the sternum, in the deep side, the heart will be located. So, got it? And next we can see that the veins and the superior vena cava and inferior vena cava, along with the arteries, the aorta and pulmonary trunk, are attached to the superior surface of the heart, which is also called as base. See, here we can see in this diagram the arteries, superior vena cava, inferior vena cava, pulmonary artery, trunk and everything over here. These are at the superior surface. Superior is also called as upper, which will be higher. So, we will be calling it as superior. So, this space is also called as base. Okay, got it? The base of the heart is located at the level of the third, and the inferior tip of the heart lies just next to the sternum, between the junction of 4th and 5th ribs, near their articulation with the coastal cartilages. See, here we can see that there is an articulation. Here, articulation means joining. So here we can see the bottom part of the heart in this picture. And the upper surface can be seen as third. See, here we can see the upper part that is also called as superior or base. And here this fourth and fifth, we can see the bottom part, which is also called as apex of the heart. Okay? These are the coastal cartilages. These are made bones which are made of cartilages, which will be protecting the heart. Next, the right side of the heart is deflected anteriorly and the left side is deflected posteriorly, which has to be noticed carefully. Along with it, the slight deviation of the effects of the left side is reflected in a depression in the medial surface of the inferior lobe. So here we can see the right side is deflected. Deflected means to change in direction. Here we can see that anterior is somewhat upper and the lower is such as depression that is downwards or innerwards. So here we can see the surface of the inferior lobe. Okay, got it? Now we'll go for the external structure of heart. It is an important aspect and we have to know. Till now we have seen the pericardial space and pericardial membrane. So that will come under external structure of the heart. The structure of the heart is a cone shape. Why it is cone shape? See the structure. Here we can see it is in a somewhat triangular shape, which can also be seen as cone shape. And the membrane or a protective layer which will be supporting and protecting the heart is called as pericardium. Here we can see the layer which is shown in a light blue color for our understanding. This is pericardium. These layers are called as pericardial layers. See, the heart is also called as pericardium, which is composed of two layers. And it is having a narrow cavity which will be filled by a fluid called as pericardial fluid. The inner layer is formerly attached to the heart wall and it is also known as visceral layer or epicardium. And outer layer, which is composed of relatively inelastic connective tissue, is called a parietal layer. Inelastic means which could not be expanded. It will be rigid connective tissue. This outer layer will help in prevention of distension of the heart along with preventing the excessive stretching of the heart muscle fibers. That means it will prevent the heart from any tension on it, or excessive stretching of the heart muscles will also be prevented. See, in between these layers, the pericardial fluid is present, which will be helping the heart to be preventive to any kind of shocks. Here we can see pericardium, this layer, and the space which is filled of pericardial fluid can also be seen. Between these two layers, the space is there now, the black color which has been shown here. It is filled of fluid, which is also called as pericardial fluid. The wall of the heart consists of three layers. Now, we will be looking after the wall of the heart. So, the three layers which are present in the wall of the heart are epicardium layer, which is also called as an external layer, the myocardium layer, and the endocardium layer. The myocardium layer is called as the middle layer and the endocardium layer is also called as inner layer. Epicardium, which is also called as exterior or the external layer, is a thin and transparent, which is composed of delicate connective tissue. See the visceral layer. This is the thin transparent layer which will be helping us to know, and it is also connected to pericardium, which is consist of connective tissue. The myocardium is comprised of cardiac muscle tissue, and the majority of the cardiac wall in the myocardium wall or a layer is responsible for the pumping action of the heart. See, this is the myocardium layer. The endocardium is a thin layer which is also called as the inner layer of the heart. See here, we can see this is the inner layer of heart. It is comprised of endothelium along with connective tissue. Here we can see the connective tissue along with endothelium tissue. Endocardium will also covers the valves and large blood vessels which is attached to the heart, or which the vessels which are attached to the heart. Now we are going to discuss about the internal structure of heart. Basically, the heart is divided into four parts: externally by grooves and internally by septum. See, here we can see the grooves which will be dividing the heart into chambers, and here we can see the septums which are dividing internally the heart. The upper chambers are the parts called as atrium or auricles, and the lower ones are called as ventricles. These chambers are also called as lobes. Upper chambers are also called as anterior lobes, and the posterior or the lower ones are called as posterior lobes. See, these two are anterior lobes or anterior chambers, and these two are called as lower lobes or posterior chambers. Walls of the ventricles are relatively thicker than that of arterial walls. The walls of the ventricles, these two are ventricles and these two are atrium. The walls of these chambers will be thicker because these will be pumping the blood to the lungs as well as to the body. So it requires a lot of strength to handle the pressure of flow of blood. On the left side, the atrium and ventricle is relatively smaller when compared to the right atrium and ventricle, because this can be seen in next slide, as the left side is near to the left lung, and that's the reason it will be in a smaller, or the other reason can be like this will be pumping the blood from lungs, and this posterior chamber will be sending the blood to whole parts of the body. So that's the reason it might to have extra pressure or force so that they can pump the blood. These atriums and ventricles are divided by the valves so that they will help in circulation and pumping of blood. Here in between these septums, we can see the walls or the valves which can be circulation and pumping of blood. The valve present on the right auriculoventricular septum between the right atrium and right ventricle are referred as a tricuspid valve. Here, between this right atrium and right ventricle, there will be a valve which will be working as a door, which is also known as tricuspid valve. The valve which is present between the left auriculoventricular septum, that is between the left atrium and the left ventricle, is referred as a bicuspid valve or a mitral valve. That is between the left auricle and left ventricle, there will be a valve which will be helping as a door, or it will be a division, which is also called as bicuspid valve or mitral valve. There are another two valves. The valve which is present at the origin of major blood vessel from the right ventricle is called as pulmonary valve. Here we can see the pulmonary valve. And the valve which is present at the origin of major blood vessel from the left ventricles is known as systemic valve. So this was the end. And the next, blood vessels and a circulatory system, or the way the blood circulation happens, will be explained in the next part of this video. If you have any queries, please comment in the section so that we can resolve it as soon as possible.